I've heard so much about Punahou School, and I've driven by here a few times, and I'm so proud to be here. And I have to ask you one question. How many of you are going to be president of the United States in about 20 years? Raise your hand. A what? Okay. Better treat him well. Actually, I had one of my Nisei friends, Missy Nagao Tanaka, actually taught at Punahou School, taught Hawaiian culture, and she was the wife of Chester Tanaka, who wrote a beautiful book on the 442nd. So the first question everybody asks me is, why do you know so much about Japanese Americans? Hakujin Haoli from California, and why are you so interested? So how did you start it? I saw a movie when I was about your age, a movie called Go for Broke. How many people have seen the movie Go for Broke? One, only one? How many people like war movies? Everybody, nobody? No. I'm in the wrong place then. Okay, how many people are on Netflix? Belong to Netflix? Okay, I want you the next week to download Go for Broke, 1954, a movie by Van Johnson. And it was a movie about Japanese American soldiers in World War II. I saw that movie in about 1965 when I was 10 years old. So you have to see that and see the story, and then you'll understand why I'm doing what I'm doing. Well, I'm from Los Angeles, California, and then San Francisco, and I did an exhibit on Japanese American soldiers in World War II. And I did it as part of a series of exhibits on minorities in the U.S. Army. I did black soldiers and Filipinos and women and Chinese. And I did, as my second exhibit, Japanese Americans in World War II. Japanese Americans in World War II, at the very beginning of World War II, were not allowed to serve in the U.S. Army. After Pearl Harbor, the U.S. government said that all Japanese Americans in Hawaii and on the West Coast were suspected of being enemies of the United States. So all young Japanese American men, probably your age, were said, you cannot serve in the Army, you can't be drafted, or you can't be volunteers. In fact, the U.S. Army said that all Japanese Americans were 4C, classified as enemy aliens. Now, could you imagine yourselves, this is 70 years ago, living in Hawaii, it only happened 70 years ago, and your government, and you're a citizen of the United States, and your government says to you that you are an enemy alien. How would you feel? What if they said, we don't want you to be in the Army and we suspect you of not being loyal? How about after 1 year after that, if the Army said to you, well, now how would you like to be a loyal citizen and fight for your government under those circumstances? If you lived in California or Oregon or Washington and you were a Japanese American and you lived in Los Angeles, Sacramento, San Jose, Medford, Oregon, Seattle, you were told in February 19, 1942, that on February 19, 1942, that all Japanese Americans living on the West Coast, and there were 120,000, you could no longer live on the West Coast. You could no longer live in your house, on your farm. You could no longer own your business. You could no longer live where you want. And we're going to give you 3 days to pack up all your belongings, and all you can take with you is two suitcases. And you're coming with us, and we're going to put you in a detention camp until we don't know when. So your mother, your father, your sister, your brother, your family, your extended family, all of your friends, and your whole community is being shipped off to prison camps for you don't know how long. Did you all know that story that happened in California? In February 19, 1942, the President of the United States signed an executive order basically suspending the civil rights of an entire group of American citizens. Now imagine you've been in a prison camp from California, Washington, Oregon, and now a year later the government says, you know what? The war is going badly, and we need volunteers to serve. You're in a prison camp, and your parents have lost everything. and you have no rights, you can't protest, you can't do anything, you have no power, how many of you would be willing to fight for your country and serve in the army? Raise your hand if you'd be willing to do that. None of you. And that's what I thought too. Why would anybody do that? Well, as it turned out, 33,000 Japanese Americans, about half from Hawaii, about 15,000, and about half from the West Coast, volunteered for the United States Army and said, we don't care if we're treated badly. We want to fight for our country. So I asked all the veterans when I did my exhibit, why did you do that? Because I couldn't understand it. So we actually have some veterans here in their late 80s and 90s. We have this gentleman. I'd like to read their names and then tell you their story. We have Robert Kishinami, H Company, 89 years old, who volunteered from Hawaii, and George Nakasato, F Company, 442nd. And how old, may I ask, are you? 88 years old, and his wife Yoshi Kishinami, and Major Lawrence Enomoto, 80 years young, and his father served as a Japanese. You're learning Japanese? His father was a Japanese linguist, and I'll tell you that story. I only have like 4 minutes to tell you a story. These men volunteered from Hawaii, even though their parents couldn't become citizens. For decades, even though they were second-class citizens. And did you know that George and Robert and Larry's father served and became among the most decorated soldiers in the whole history of the United States Army? They won more medals for heroism and unit citations than any other unit in the 240-year history of the American Army. Can you believe that? How many people didn't know that? Raise your hand. And you're hearing this for the first time. Well, I'm glad that Lieutenant Colonel DeGau has invited us here to tell the story. And I invite you, when you hear what I say, tell all your friends, and then go on Netflix and watch Go for Broke. So Japanese Americans served in Europe, in France, in Italy. And Robert and George, you both were in Italy and France? Fought in Italy and France in 8 major battles, and they won 8 presidential unit citations, and they won 18,000 medals, their unit. And it was called the 442nd Regimental Combat Team and the 100th Infantry Battalion. And Larry's father, this is the most incredible story, and I couldn't make it up if I was the greatest writer of all time. There were 6,000 Japanese Americans, like yourself, learning the Japanese language. They spoke a little bit of Japanese that they learned at home, but they went to school in Minneapolis and St. Paul, and they learned to speak military Japanese. And as a result, they were able to predict what the Japanese Army was going to be doing by reading their radio signals, reading their diaries, their letters and orders, and interrogating Japanese prisoners in the field. And because you're studying Japanese, I'll tell you that the net effect of all these men who served in the military intelligence corps, and this is the most unbelievable thing, and put this in the back of your minds, the second most important intelligence officer in the whole army in World War II said that the Japanese Americans shortened the war in the Pacific by 2 years, and saved 1 million lives. So that's how important language skill is and what these Japanese Americans did. And when they came home, they became brave and proud American citizens, and they worked to change all the discriminatory laws that existed in Hawaii, here in Hawaii, and in California. And did you know, if you lived in California and Hawaii in the 1930s and 40s, if I were to tell you that there were 500 laws against you, what would you think? And it's absolutely true. Laws against Chinese, Japanese, and Filipino, there were 500 laws, which meant you couldn't own land, you couldn't become a citizen, you couldn't vote, you couldn't live in certain areas, you couldn't own certain businesses, and hundreds of other laws. And the veterans who you see went and helped change the laws of the United States And all those laws were taken off the books by the very work of Japanese Americans like Spark Matsunaga and Dan Inoue and Tadao Beppu and the hundreds and thousands of other Japanese who made our life better. So before I tell you the slideshow, I understand many of you have great uncles and grandfathers or great grandfathers in the Japanese American units. Raise your hand if you had a relative in the Japanese American units. Anybody? Well, you should be. So we have about five people or six people. Well, you should be so proud. And I asked your grandfathers and your granduncles and your relatives, why were you so brave? Why did you do what you did? It's because they wanted you to have a better life. They knew someday they would have children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. And like you, they wanted them to have a better life than they did. And in fact, you do have a better life because of that. So this isn't just a war story about brave men who helped win World War II, but they were fighting for your rights and to prove that anybody who lives in this country shouldn't be judged by their race, the color of their skin, their ethnicity, or anything. And that's the moral of the story. So you couldn't make up a more beautiful, heroic, and moral story. And I'm so proud that you are here to listen. And I want to show you a little slideshow that I prepared, some pictures of the history of Japanese in America and how the Japanese American soldiers changed our history. And why don't we turn the chairs around so the veterans can see the... So stand up. And we'll, you know what, let's give the veterans a round of applause. I only hope that we can make it into our late 80s and do as well. I also want to introduce Rosemary Anzai, whose father was Arthur Komori, who fought in the Pacific as a military intelligence. So, Rosemary, would you stand up and wave? Her father was a great hero of the United States. Is that a right click or left click? Left. So this is pictures of Japanese coming to the United States for the first time. Do you know when Japanese came to the United States? 1885. And these are original photographs that we collected in California and here in Hawaii. Why did Japanese come to the country? The same reason my grandparents came here about the same time, for a better life. To work, to raise a family, to own a little business, a farm, to raise children and have a good life. These are the actual pictures that we collect. These are the, this is actually Missy Tanaka's mother who taught here. This is Marshall Sumida's mother who was in the military intelligence. This is her after she'd been in the United States for 10 years, from a kimono to a modern dress. Japanese Americans came here with a dream of a better life. They only came here, they felt temporarily, and they were going to make some money and then maybe go back to Japan. But you know, they actually found a better life here. This is an original passport of a Japanese American woman who came here at the turn of the century. When she came here in 1905, it took her 60 years to become a citizen. And the Japanese came here because to work in the fields, pineapples and sugar. And as you know your Hawaiian history, they were basically slaves, indentured servants, working for a dollar a day or less, doing slave labor with no rights as citizens and no rights as workers and no unions. And in California, though, they were able to build little businesses, little flower stores and grocery stores and tiny farms and orchards. So they decided maybe they would stay here, maybe they would have children and put down roots. And they stayed. And this year, by the way, is the 129th year of Japanese in America. So those kids there would be your grandfathers and great-grandfathers. And they took these pictures, these proud pictures, in their best Sunday clothes, and they sent them back to their relatives in Japan to show how well they were doing. And they did very well. They even served in the U.S. Army in World War I. This is an extremely rare photograph of a Japanese officer, an Nisei officer. And they were promised that they could become citizens if they served in the Army. But actually, the Army reneged, and they were not allowed to become citizens until almost 40 years later. These are ROTC cadets here in Hawaii. Another photograph of Boy Scouts in Hawaii in 1917. This is a kendo class in Hawaii about 1920. That's my favorite photograph. These are Japanese Issei, your great-grandmothers, raising money for the U.S. Army in World War I. And these are children in a little World War I victory parade. Aren't these great photographs? The photographs are over 120 years old now. Another kendo class in California. So all these photographs came from Japanese American veterans who were my friends. And we actually collected about 3,000 photographs for this slideshow. So this is California in the 1920s. And young Nisei students in the 1940s, just before World War II. This is a Japanese American pikuniku. That's how you said Japanese picnic in Japanese, pikuniku. And this is Yoshi Tanabe, who is a good friend of mine who lives in Honolulu. Her father had a little plantation workshop. This is a Japanese American family in 1941. And a few days after this photograph was taken, they lost all of their property. There was one, a Japanese-American civil rights unit that helped defend their rights. This is the 298th and 299th National Guard, Territorial Guard in Hawaii. And there were many Japanese-Americans serving in the unit. Right after Pearl Harbor, they were told you had to get out and give up your guns. You couldn't be in the Territorial National Guard anymore. And this is one of my friends. It was one of the people kicked out. So in Pearl Harbor was a decisive changing moment for all Japanese living in the United States. It was a horrible moment where they realized that the land of their ancestry had attacked the land of their birth and of their choice. And their choice was to be loyal and good Americans and fight for their country. But almost nobody trusted them. In Hawaii, luckily, there were people of goodwill. And very few people in Hawaii were actually interned, only 2,000 from Hawaii. And the reason was because people were more reasonable and the community worked together. These are Nisei college students from University of Hawaii, Manoa, and they volunteered to do work for the Army. Volunteer engineering, they dug ditches and they built buildings. And they proved, even without guns, that they had loyalty and they would be willing to work for the Army. And they were called the Varsity Victory Volunteers. Have you heard of the Varsity Victory Volunteers? Very famous story. This was the notification by the United States government that people of Japanese ancestry could no longer be protected by the Constitution of the United States. They lost all of their civil rights. This is a map where all the Japanese Americans lived. Japanese Americans were only 0.3% in California of the total population. Unlike Hawaii, where they're about one-third. They were sent to 10 camps, 120,000 people, mostly in the West, mostly in the worst areas you could think of, in Idaho, in Wyoming, in Texas, in Colorado. This is a chart showing that Japanese Americans, even though they were only 0.3% of the population in California, owned 14% of all the farmlands in California and produced about 40% of the fruits and vegetables. And we argue that one of the reasons that they were interned was a lot of people were jealous of them and influenced the federal government to pass a law against them in order to displace them from their land. So the Army designated all the lands on the West Coast from the coast inland to 500 miles and called them exclusion areas. This is a picture in San Francisco. Now imagine yourself, this is 70 years ago, this happened actually 73 years ago. Imagine your mother and your father and your sister and your brother living in your beautiful house, and you have to get on a line with two bags, get on a bus or a train, and they're going to send you to a prison camp. You don't even know where that is, or how long, or that even if you're going to be treated safely. They didn't know a thing. They weren't told a thing except get up and go. And these photographs were taken by a very famous photographer. You've heard of Ansel Adams. He took some of these photographs. Clem Albers and Walker Evans. These photographs show how sad Japanese Americans were and how traumatic that experience. Imagine yourself. I always ask you to be empathetic and think of yourself. What would be going through your mind if you had to give up everything that you owned, your room and your books and your possessions, and lost everything? Would you be loyal to your country? Aren't these heartbreaking photographs? Are you seeing these for the first time? When I first saw these photographs, they just broke my heart, and I just couldn't understand how Japanese American men, like our heroes, could be willing to overlook the disappointment and stay loyal. This is on Seattle. All the Japanese Americans are being removed from their homes, have to cross. They're on an island called Bainbridge Island. Did anybody see the movie Snow Falling on Cedars or read the book? It's actually based on Japanese Americans on Bainbridge Island. So this was right near my house. It's a racetrack called Tanforan. It was a shopping center. It was a racetrack, and 10,000 Japanese Americans from San Francisco left their houses and were moved into horse stalls. So at first they didn't even have any place to put them except for horse stalls. And they had American soldiers guarding them with machine guns. So all these Japanese Americans are being guarded by their fellow citizens with bayonets and machine guns. So they're being moved, and this is in Manzanar, California. It's in Northern California. It's a desolate area where there's nothing except blowing sand and hot in the summer and freezing in the winter. And all of these barracks didn't have insulation. They just wood walls with tar paper. So it was freezing and hot and freezing and hot in the middle of the desert. So the food that you ate was army food. It was beans and pork, and you had guard towers. That's the symbol, you know, I think of World War II and what happened. And young people behind barbed wire with no place to go. But this is pictures in Hawaii. The Japanese were allowed 1 year later to volunteer for the service. And in Hawaii, they asked for 2,500 Japanese Americans to serve. And would you believe 10,000 people volunteered for service? And this is a very famous picture of them volunteering and being sworn in front of the Iloni Palace. This is a photograph of them waiting to get on the trains and then the boats and go to California and train in a place called Camp Shelby, Mississippi. That's Baratania Avenue, and that's their parade. That's Senator Inouye as a 19-year-old with his mother just before he went overseas. Now, in California, when you volunteered for the service, you volunteered from an internment camp, and these are very rare photographs of Niseis volunteering from service from behind barbed wire. Again, imagine what's going through your mind. You're going off to fight for your country where your parents are still in prison camps. You don't know what's going to happen or if you'll even come home alive. And it was a very dangerous war, and yet they did it. This is four Nisei brothers volunteering, leaving their mother and father, even their children behind in an detention camp. The fathers, what did the fathers say to the sons? Be brave, fight well, and don't bring shame on the family, don't embarrass us. And they didn't embarrass they went and trained, and they came up with a nickname and a motto for what they did, and it was called Go for Broke. That was the motto. This is them training. And this is Senator Inouye right here when he was training. That's a very rare photograph as well. So when they trained, they won all the records for training, for marching and shooting and for maneuvers and practice. So at first the army said, well, we don't know what to do with you. Are we going to send you to Europe or Italy or France? And at first, after training, no Army officer in Europe wanted Japanese Americans because of the suspicion. But finally, there was an officer named Mark Clark in Italy who said, yes, I know Japanese Americans because I grew up in California, and I have no prejudice against them, so give them to me for Italy. So they were sent to Italy. So 6,000 Japanese Americans were sent to fight in Italy for several months. And right from the start, they were proving their bravery. Right from the start, there was no question that they were brave soldiers that would do anything that was told them to do. I was the shortest man in the 442nd. You know what his nickname was? Shorty. He was 5'2", and he wore size 2 shoes. The average age was about 21, and they weighed about 120 pounds soaking wet. And like you kids, they were smart. Their average IQ was 116, about 10 points higher than you needed to be an officer in the Army. So these are some group pictures just before they went overseas. And you can see how proud they were. And they would send these pictures home to their parents. And their parents were proud. And everybody was holding their breath. What was going to happen? Was the Army going to treat them well? Were they going to do well? Were they going to prove themselves? And they wanted to know that, and wanted you to know, I'm telling you that when they went off to sea, they did it for their children and grandchildren. You, who are the living their legacy. So here inside the camps are these big signs. These are all the names of Japanese Americans who volunteered from the various internment camps in California. These are two Issei mothers. Each of them had 4 sons in the Army. And they were called Blue Star Mothers. For every son that you had in the Army would give you a little flag that had a blue star, and you would put it in your window. And that window would say that you had a son or a husband in the Army. And here they're sewing a flag full of blue stars that would show all the Japanese Americans volunteering from a particular internment camp. From this camp, 500. From Amachi, Colorado, a camp, there were 953 Japanese Americans volunteering. When you came home for training to see your parents for the last time, you had to go to a relocation camp. And you had to see your parents and your sisters and your friends still behind barbed wire, but still the Nisei didn't lose faith in their country, didn't lose faith in that they could do a better job. Some of them got married and had children, but still went off to war. Aren't these sweet photographs? Look at their innocent faces. So before they go to war, they didn't really know how bad it was going to be, and they were in some of the hardest fighting in the Army at the time. These are children. This is Easter egg time, Easter egg hunt in one of the camps. And this man in the hat was a very famous person in Hawaii. He was a white farmer who used to do shows and picnics and barbecues and luaus for the Nisei before they went off to war. This is a very rare photograph showing them getting on the train. They would be going to New Jersey and getting on a steamship and go to Italy. So these are the rare photographs of our Nisei friends fighting in their first battle. This is Burns' father. Burns, raise your hand. That's Burns' father. What was your father's name?
Victor
Yamashita. And here you show them capturing the German soldiers and marching and fighting and fighting and winning 8 presidential unit citations. No other unit that small had won that many honors, 8 presidential unit citations and 33,000 medals or 18,000 medals for heroism. Just imagine yourself being one of those people. How dangerous was it? About 10% of all Japanese Americans who fought in this were killed, 1 out of every 10, almost 10%. And about 314% were wounded. So 314, that the unit had to be replaced with new soldiers 3 full times because so many people were being wounded. And the volunteers came from Hawaii and from the mainland in the camps. This is a church service. This is the Secretary of the Army, Patterson, and the general. This is the general who wanted them to come to Italy, General Mark Clark, a great hero and a friend to the Niseis, who trusted them and said, "Give me all you've got, because I need soldiers, and I trust them." And it was because of his courage that Japanese Americans had a place even to fight. This is young Oh Kim. He was a Korean who served with the unit, who volunteered to serve with his buddies, who he grew up with in Los Angeles. Wherever the Nisei went overseas, they made friends with all the local kids and the orphans. They gave them candy bars and they had parties for them. This is a prayer service in Italy. And they were in the middle of their Italian campaign. They were said, "We're going to send you all to France. We need you to fight in France." So from Italy, they went to a place called Marseille. And from Marseille, they were sent to a place near Nice to liberate this actual town. This town is called Bruyères. It's on the French-German border. And they fought for over a week fighting to liberate the town from the Germans. And these are rare photographs of that fighting. And in basically a week and a half, 2,000 people were killed and wounded in about 8 days of fighting. In the middle of the fighting, after they liberated the town, they had to go into the forest. This was called the Vosges Mountains, and rescue their fellow Texas soldiers, the Hakujin soldiers, who had been trapped. So 2,000 Niseis went to rescue 200 people and lost about 800 people rescuing 200. So the forest was a dense, dense forest. And in France, it's called the Vosges. On the German side, on the border, it's called the Black Forest. And this forest had never been attacked and conquered in the history of warfare in Europe. But the Niseis were able to win every battle that they were in. This is called the Battle for the Rescue of the Lost Battalion. Were you guys in the Lost Battalion fight?
No.
Were you in? Raise your hand. We have one person who actually lived through the Lost Battalion fight. So he's a very lucky man. Shake his hand afterwards and get some good luck. This is after they rescued that Lost Battalion, and there was a big parade that honored them. And the general who had his soldiers saved thanked the Niseis for their bravery. But he didn't realize how many people were lost, that in the total fighting, 2,000 were lost. And these are the actual soldiers that were saved by the Japanese Americans. There's four photographs. These were the soldiers in that rescued Lost Battalion. So just before these photos were taken, their lives were saved. And they thought Japanese Americans were saints. They thought they were like angels who came down from heaven to save their lives. And you know, when you see these pictures, you know, these guys became friends, dear friends. And they became so close, and I've known them now for 35 years, and they've become very dear friends, like my fathers and my uncles. And they're so sweet. They taught me kindness and patience and loyalty and to look on the bright side and to be an optimist. So my working on this exhibit and learning these things taught me a lesson how to be a better human being. These are extremely rare photographs of taken actually during the fighting when they returned to Italy. After in France, they went to Italy for the second time, and they had to go to the top of this mountain to capture a German outpost up here. And it was defended for 6 months, and the Japanese Americans climbed this mountain and knocked the Germans off that mountain. In 35 minutes, they basically attacked a position that couldn't be defended and conquered in 6 months. So the war ends, and everybody is relieved. Finally, we get to go home. Finally, maybe we can go back. We're alive. This was the last parade that they had in France, in Italy, in a place called Leghorn. So look at the pride in their faces. They're going to go home, and they're not going to go back like they were before. They're going to go back and change things. They have been changed, and when they come back, they're going to make our lives better. They're going to change all those 500 laws, all that discrimination in Hawaii and in California. This is Senator Inouye. This is the only combat photograph we have of him just before he lost his arm. This is F Company. This is a soldier who had went back to take a picture for the mother of one of their friends who had been killed in France. And these are the saddest photographs I've ever seen. These are the photographs of the mothers and fathers and the wives of the Niseis who had been killed. And the funerals were being held in American internment camps, in prison camps. So these are the mothers, sisters, and brothers of the 717 soldiers that were killed. There were 717 Japanese-Americans killed in this unit. And this is the net effect of the, on the mothers and the fathers and the sisters and the brothers. And I always say, the proof of a loyalty of any human being is his willingness to give up his life for his friend or for his country. There's a saying in the Bible that says, no greater love has a man than this than to give up his life for his friend. Has anybody ever heard that phrase? An Issei mother who lost her son. And a Japanese-American soldier and a family member buried in the deserts in California. So Japanese-Americans came home to Hawaii, thousands of soldiers who came here proudly. And the parade, when they came home in 1946, was miles long. And everybody knew that they were the most decorated unit. And nobody could believe that they had proved their loyalty so much. And every newspaper, I have all these news clippings from the Honolulu Star Bulletin saying, great heroes, most decorated unit. And they proved forever to everybody's satisfaction, the loyalty and the patriotism and the courage of Japanese Americans. Even the President of the United States, Harry Truman, invited the Japanese Americans as they were coming home to have a special parade on the White House. He told them how brave they were and how they had defended the Constitution by serving in the Army and how they had to make the Constitution stand and fight for the justice of all Americans. This is General Stilwell giving the second highest medal to Mary Masuda in California. And in that ceremony, General Stilwell had an assistant giving a speech about patriotism. The name of that captain in 1946 was Ronald Reagan. He gave a speech honoring Japanese Americans. And in 1988, he signed a bill apologizing, having the United States government apologize to every Japanese American for the internment. How many people knew about that? The United States government apologized for interning Japanese Americans in the war. Raise your hand if you knew that. Very good, okay. It was called the American Civil Liberties Act of 1988. And the bill number, it was House Resolution 442, named after Japanese American soldiers. So these are photographs of the soldiers coming home with their proud, proud parents. Look at the smile, isn't that sweet? And the stories they would tell. But you know, they didn't tell their children and their wives the war stories because it was too painful to them. So they kept for years, for over 60 years, they kept the stories to themselves. And even today, a lot of the veterans don't want to talk about it because they don't want to brag. And it's still painful because of all their friends that they lost. So now Japanese Americans, the mothers and fathers of the veterans could now, in 1954, become citizens. And these are pictures of the parents of the soldiers becoming citizens. And then the soldiers went to Washington to lobby to make the territory of Hawaii the 50th state. And some people say had there not been Japanese Americans in the 442nd, it would have taken much longer for Hawaii to become a state. We have Governor Ariyoshi, first Japanese American governor, and Sparky Matsunaga and Senator Inouye in front of the president signing the bill to study the internment of Japanese Americans on the West Coast. Chief of Staff of the Army, Eric Shinseki, said without the Niseis, he could not have been the general. He stood on the shoulders of all the heroes. This is the actual letter that was sent to every Japanese American who had been interned during the war. And it was called Resolution 442. This is one of the presidential unit citations, of which they won 8. This is the two senators, Sparky and Dan, coming to the exhibit that we did in 1981. And in 2000, 21 Japanese Americans got the Medal of Honor retroactively. And these are two of my friends, Wally Nutani and Mel Tominaga, in France, honoring one of their friends. Thank you so much. Would our veterans please stand up and take another bow? You know, I hope you always remember this, and I would like you to, everyone, shake their hand and thank them for what they did, because you have a better life because of what they did. Do you agree?
Yeah. I agree for myself.
Do you agree? You wanted your kids to have a better life, and that's why they went off. And they always ask me to tell the stories because they're too endyo to do that. You know what endyo means? Do you know what oyakoko means? Kodomo no tamine, shikata ga nai, shimboshite sekosuru. These were the values that their parents taught them about honesty, loyalty, bravery, loyalty to your family, doing things for your children, and that's why they went off to war. They taught me my little Japanese that I know. Do we have time for questions, or how are we doing for time? Is my Japanese accent okay? And a round of applause for the veterans. One more round of applause. And shake their head. Everybody go up there, shake their hand. Or shake his hand.
To present this book of
Punahou. Oh,
thank you for coming.
Oh, thank you. I wish I went here. I'm jealous. Thank you all. Domo arigatou gozaimasu.
Just all another round of applause.